grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Well, a hearty welcome to each and every one of you at this service of worship at Central Saanich United Church, and I see you've got your name tags on. And I understand that name tags were constructed sometime before I was here, and so some of you may have those. But if not, let us know. I think there's a plan afoot to get some more made, the nice ones. But these will do for now. It's just great for us to share our names with one another, especially as we do have some new people who have been attending from time to time. So welcome everyone, people in person and people online. Please note that next week is Remembrance Sunday, featuring traditions and songs and themes related to our remembrance of those who gave the ultimate sacrifice. We'll acknowledge wars past and those that are continuing, and we will be reminded that we are to be people of peace within our personal lives and in the life of the world. It's that time of year again when our outreach committee, and Marion Garnett specifically from that committee, will be looking for angels to provide the Christmas gifts to folks that frequent Our Place. That's the organization that provides services and programs for the vulnerable, poor, the homeless, and those individuals and families who attempt to survive on low income. So there will be a letter coming out to you by email soon, and with that will come instructions. So we'll have that for you. I don't have a lot of announcements today, and I'll commend to you reading the announcements in the bulletin and on the screen in terms of upcoming meetings, but I'm wondering if there are any other announcements, especially with regard to things that are coming up. Anything about the bazaar, Helen?
No, just that it's coming up.
Okay.
Actually, we are looking for donations for our attic treasures and donations for our bake table. So if you have some, come and talk to myself or Marlene or any of the UCW ladies, and we could use some help.
Thank you very much. Yes, it's getting late into the year, so as I say, remember Sunday is next Sunday, and then Advent isn't all that far away, November 27th, at which time we'll have the sacrament of Holy Communion and move on into that holy season. And I will be offering a study this year, and I'll have more to say about that later on. I think there was something about it in the newsletter. Are there any other announcements or things to share with one another, as well as celebrations, anniversaries, birthdays?
Oh. Yeah.
Oh!
I'm 39 again.
Yeah!
The 39th.
No, 39 already. That's wonderful. Anyone else with a birthday?
When was your birthday?
Friday.
Last
Friday.
Let's sing for Helen.
Yes.
Happy birthday to you.
In the 8th century, Pope Gregory III designated November 1st as a time to honor saints. And the evening before All Saints' Day was known as All Hallows' Eve, which we call Halloween. And on Halloween, many of us will turn on porch lights and place flaming candles into pumpkins to light the way for little trick-or-treaters. But when we gather on Sunday mornings, we light a candle representing Christ, who lights the way for our daily living.
And let's join together in singing our opening hymn for today's service, Come to My Heart.
Reshaping us.
Opening our hearts and minds to your will for us,
your love for us,
and your invitation to us to live with you and one another in right relationship.
Act upon us, we pray, in this time of worship and in the midst of our everyday lives, reminding us who we are and whose we are.
We pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Well, it's the time now set aside for children, for the child within. So, I'm not going to center folks out, the tallest, the smallest, but I want to have you think back and remember if you ever had your height marked on a door frame or on a wall somewhere. Can you remember? Usually with a pencil, each year on your birthday as you got older, usually. How many remember that? Or have done that with their own kids? Sure. Right. That's right. Now, so I can recall, I think I want to get a sense of our height without centering people out. Although I can tell who the tallest is. I can tell who the smallest is. But who here is 6'3" or taller? Put your hand up if you're not too shy. No one's 6'3" or taller. That surprises me. I thought someone would. How about 6 foot taller? Ah, okay. 2. Hey, we're a short crowd. How many are under 5'6"? 5'6" or less? Okay, how about 5'4"? Okay, so 3. All right, okay, so we have obviously different heights. With kids, it's fun at the front because you can have them back to back. Have lots of fun with that. But I had some fun with the big kids, so that's good. I can remember being small, so some of you will relate to this, I'm sure. I think I was 5 years old. My first experience at the Santa Claus parade. And of course, when you're small, you can't see. I couldn't see. So I remember my dad putting me on his shoulders. So some of you may remember that or have done that. I've done that with my kids. And going to a movie theater. You'd sit in the seat and you couldn't see past the people in front of you. Of course, that still happens. You know, people have their hair up really high or a big hat or something. But and I remember not being allowed to go on certain rides at the fairs. Do you remember that? There's usually a little clown that says if you're not taller than this, you can't go on the ride. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Is that? Yeah.
What I remember is being told, no, you're too tall, you're not allowed to go on the pony.
So sometimes it works the other way.
Yeah.
No, yeah, for some of us it's too heavy to go on the pony. Well, there's a Bible story about a man who was very short. His name was Zacchaeus. There's a song about him, and you may have heard it, so the song will tell a bit of the story. Sing along if you know this. Zacchaeus in the tree, he was greatly disliked, and we'll talk a little more about that in the sermon. But essentially he was a thief, he was a crook, and he was oppressing the people in his hometown. And he would keep a lot of money for himself at the expense of those in the city he lived. But then Jesus came along, and he had lunch with Jesus. He got to know Jesus, and Jesus got to know him. A relationship form. And I think that's a little story that we can think about as, you know, the church. We get to know Jesus, we have a relationship with him, we learn about him and his teachings, and we can be changed for the better. Or we can stay on the right path. So that's one of the reasons we go to church, I think, right? Because we get to know Jesus, we study the Bible, we worship. We grow, we sing together, we pray together, we have meals together. That's, I think, a little story that reflects what we are all about as church. So that we will grow and continue to grow into people who do good to others and change like Zacchaeus for the better. So let's pray. Repeat after me. Thank you, God, for the stories of Jesus.
Thank you, God, for the stories of Jesus.
Help us to learn from these stories.
Help us to learn from these stories.
To be like him.
To be like him.
In his name we pray. Amen.
In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Well, there certainly are many ways we come to know God. In the reading and study of Scripture, in nature, in various spiritual traditions, in music, contemplation, prayer, sacrament. Psalm 46 declares to us another way to come to know God. Be still and know that I am God. In other versions, be silent and know that I am God. So let us do that. Let us enter into a time of silence so that we might better know and experience God's presence in our lives.
Today's special song offering will be set to a familiar tune, but the words are written by Carolyn. And I'm sorry, I can't tell you Carolyn's last name, but she has her own website, Carolyn's Hymns, and she writes words for many different Bible stories and sets them to various tunes. So this is from her, Helen and Pat. Come on forward and share. This is called Welcoming God. And because you probably know the melody, if you want to sing along with the melody, just hum along or something like that. Let me start that again.
Children are
priest.
Let us pray. God of the prophets and poets, the seers and storytellers of Scripture, thank you for the ancient visions of your truth, which still guide us. Send us your Spirit in this day to open our minds and hearts to the word you have for us in our time. In the name of Jesus Christ, your living word. Amen. The prophet Habakkuk lived in the time of Jeremiah when the Babylonian Empire was growing in power. Not long before the empire's army invaded Judah, around the last quarter of the 7th century BC. Here the prophet laments the injustice and suffering he witnesses. He complains to God of God's seeming lack of response to his cries for help. Habakkuk takes the role of a watchman, waiting for God to respond to his complaint. In the waiting, the prophet is assured that God will indeed respond. Reading from chapters 1 and 2, this is only part of his rant. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, judgment comes forth, perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what God will say to me and what God will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write down this vision. Make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The gospel reading features the story of Zacchaeus. The story demonstrates several important themes: Jesus' welcoming of outsiders, the character of faith and repentance, the right use of money and possessions, and the presence of God's salvation in the world. So reading from the 9th chapter of the Gospel according to Luke. He entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, he has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner. Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much. Then Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the human one came to seek out and to save the lost. May God bless to our understanding these readings from the Holy Scriptures.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Mama. Before I begin, I just wanted to say how that first reading, Habakkuk, is from one of my favorite books. And someone had tweeted to me that, yeah, that's the kind of thing we need to hear, I think, in this day and age. So stay tuned. We'll eventually have a sermon, I think, that touches on Habakkuk and his concern that he doesn't hear from God in the midst of all the things that are going on in his world. But today I'm preaching on Zacchaeus, so let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, certainly the story of Zacchaeus is one of the most popular, best known of the gospel stories. And many of us, as we explored in children's time, remember him as a kind of cartoon character. As children, we sang that silly song that we heard earlier. We may have drawn pictures of him. By the way, if anyone wants a picture of him to take to a young one, I have a few here that can be taken with you. So we, Sunday school, yeah, that we would draw pictures of him. And even his name would elicit a grin for those of us who were growing up in that tradition. It is an interesting story. An outrageous story, actually. For here we have a wealthy, powerful man scrambling up a tree to catch a glimpse of Jesus. He has to do that because he was too short to see over the crowd. And we might imagine who would be Zacchaeus in this day and age. Perhaps a well-known but unpopular politician. Maybe a maligned company CEO. Whatever one might say about this story, I would suggest it is one of the most powerful and provocative stories in all of Scripture. So let's take a look at Zacchaeus and the world he lived in. Jericho, where he resided, was a veritable Eden, an oasis of date palms and balsam groves. It exported its products all around the known world. There had been a day when Mark Antony presented Jericho as a gift to Cleopatra, with Arabia thrown in. The city lay along the great caravan routes and was a beehive of commercial and social activity. Now, we met a tax collector, I think it was last Sunday, praying in the temple. And I spoke of the thieving, oppressive, and even violent ways of tax collection in a system of tax collection that was rife with corruption. But Zacchaeus was no ordinary tax collector. He was the chief tax collector for the Roman government in this prosperous city. In all likelihood, he had in his service a sizable staff of employees. Zacchaeus worked for the occupying forces, and he was regarded as a traitor by his own people. He and his cohorts could stop a person in Jericho and assess duty taxes on nearly everything in his or her possession. A cart, for instance, could be taxed for each wheel, for the animal that pulled it, and for the merchandise it carried. And Zacchaeus would send on to the Roman government a portion of his collections, and anything over that amount he was free to keep. As I said, the system was ripe for abuse. And this scripture passage tersely states, he was rich, as if it were some sort of indictment. And it was, for he had accumulated his wealth in service to the invaders and at the expense of Jericho's citizens. He was regarded as human filth. Zacchaeus, whose name meant the pure one or the righteous one had turned his name into a sneer on the people's lips. He was a standing joke. And the mention of his name did not evoke a grin, but disgust. Well, for him, I'm sure the money was nice, but to live as an outcast among your own people with no one to call a friend, no social life, no involvement with others except those who wanted to use him for their own ends, well, it had to be a lonely and depressing existence. Along comes Jesus. Many of the people there consider Jesus a prophet sent by God, perhaps even the long-awaited Messiah. Yet Jesus is so different from the would-be messiahs of his time. After all, in the stories he tells, it's the tax collectors who become the heroes and the religious leaders the villains. Jesus comes into town with a reputation for being comfortable with those on the fringes of society. Children, women, as we sung about in our song, and those rejected by the trends of culture found in him a listening ear and a warm reception. So he was worth checking out. But for Zacchaeus, checking him out was easier said than done. Zacchaeus was short, and seeing over through a crowd was a real challenge. And trying to squeeze through a crowd to the front was not a sure thing either. In the confusion of the moment, sharp elbows would fly when people in the crowd saw the hated Zacchaeus vulnerable in their midst. So his only hope was to skirt around the crowd and find a sycamore tree with its low spreading branches that afforded a ringside view of the way Jesus was to come. And so that's what he did. He waited there in that tree, not quite knowing what to expect as Jesus came into view. Now let me say something about his stature. I believe the author of this story wants us to recognize that his shortness of stature was not just about physical height. More importantly, it was about his spiritual stature. His was a spiritual condition that affects people of all ages, shapes, and sizes. It's part of the human condition. And it's one of the threads that runs through this morning's readings. In today's first reading, Habakkuk must have been feeling short in stature when he cried out, "O God, how long shall I cry out for help and you will not listen, or cry to you violence and you will not save?" Surely he felt small as he witnessed injustice, destruction, and violence all around him. And as I mentioned earlier, Habakkuk's world doesn't seem all that much different from ours. Look at our world today, and chances are we too, from time to time, feel small, ineffective, overwhelmed, crushed by the weight of everything that's going on, short in spiritual stature. And many of the Psalms describe this. In Psalm 119, we read these words, "I am small and of no account." And in today's gospel reading, we have Zacchaeus, an outcast whose people look down upon and consider beneath the dignity of other folks. So one question I have is, have you ever felt like Zacchaeus? Have you experienced being short in spiritual stature? It happens. It happens in all sorts of ways. See if any of what I'm about to describe fits, is familiar to you. Has life ever cut you down to size? Have you ever felt less than others, insignificant, ignored, of little importance? Have you ever felt you just don't measure up, that somehow you're not enough? Do you sometimes feel as if you're on the outside, never an insider? Does it seem you can't outgrow your past or the opinions of others toward you? Are you constantly trying to prove yourself, not just to others, but to yourself or even to God? Does it seem as if your life is not growing, maturing, or deepening? Have you ever felt powerless and overwhelmed by the circumstances of your life? Does it sometimes seem as if your value, worth, and dignity have been defined by your past actions and choices, which you have done or left undone? And have you ever experienced being lost, alienated, ignored in the crowds of life? Have you ever felt as if you weren't up to what life was asking of you? Well, if you answered yes to any one of those questions, then you know what it's like to be short in stature. You know how Zacchaeus felt that day as he waited to see Jesus. Well, let's get back to Zacchaeus up in the tree. As Jesus passed by, he stops and looks up at him. And we know Jesus had eyes that saw what others missed. This uncanny vision allowed him to see into people and situations that others would not even notice. And he didn't miss seeing Zacchaeus. Jesus calls to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." Well, Zacchaeus wasted no time in scrambling down that tree, and we are told he was happy to welcome Jesus. I'm sure he was happy. No one came calling for Zacchaeus, unless it was to complain or pay a debt. House guest was a rare exception to his lonely life. Now, I suppose he could have stayed up in that tree and rebuffed Jesus' invitation. Plenty of people do that. It's certainly much easier to go on with life as usual, to continue our preoccupation with our agendas, our schedules, our daily chores and appointments, than to allow a Messiah to invite himself over for lunch and delve into our inner core. That is risky business, to allow such a person into that part of us where our true self resides. However, Zacchaeus takes the risk and invites Jesus into his inner room. And it was a lunch to remember. At the same time, it was a bitter pill to swallow for those in the crowd. After all, what kind of so-called Messiah would even acknowledge, much less share a meal with the most notorious sinner in town? Luke says they began to grumble about Jesus. Well, we don't really know what happened at Zacchaeus' home. All we see are the results, and those results tell us a great deal. He makes a two-pronged pledge to give half of his possessions to the poor and to return any stolen funds four times over. The religious law only required restitution of money plus 20%. Zacchaeus thought 400% interest was more appropriate. Something in that encounter with Jesus changed the way that Zacchaeus saw the world. In his encounter with Jesus, he became what his name meant, pure and righteous. He became right, in right relationship with God and with people. He could now see people in need, when before he saw people he wanted to cheat. Is that not one of the profound things that Jesus does to our lives? He changes how we see other people. No longer do labels or stereotypes work. Poor, rich, conservative, liberal, white, black, indigenous, settler, gay, straight. Now we see people who are as needy as we are, as beloved by God as we are, to be respected and treated with kindness. Now we see neighbors and strangers and even enemies with the eyes of Jesus. Salvation comes to Zacchaeus, and he is forever changed from a taker to a giver. This man who had made a handsome living taking from others, and now after inviting Jesus into his home, into his heart, he is giving generously of himself to others. One commentator suggests this meeting with Jesus redeemed Zacchaeus' past, it transformed his present, and it redirected his future. Isn't that what God wants to do with all of us? To redeem our past, to transform our present, and to redirect our future. This is the story of the power of the grace of God to genuinely change people. to make us more of who we are meant to be, authentic and real, loving and kind and generous of spirit. I suspect that the change Zacchaeus experienced cost him dearly, and not just monetarily. In short order, he would likely be out of a job, possibly fired, because he no longer would be collecting as much tax as the Roman overlords would want. Or possibly he would resign because his job no longer fit his values. There is a somewhat dubious tradition that later on, Zacchaeus became the bishop at Caesarea. It makes for a nice ending, all the same. But this is no nursery story. This is a story, a true story, at least in the sense of how we all can be changed in our encounter with Jesus. It's a picture, a miniature of the mission of Jesus, received by the outcast, saving the lost, grumbled at by the fickle crowds, condemned by the authorities. And it starts with a little man in a tree, and it ends with the biggest heart that Jesus encountered in all of Israel. So I invite you to find a vantage point and watch to see what Jesus is up to. But beware, he may stop where you are. No matter how comfortable or complacent or secure or even immobile you are, he may look at you and invite you down, down so that he might go home with you. And what joy there is for us if Christ is in our homes and in our hearts. For Jesus reveals to us how God sees the goodness in us, our purity, our righteousness, sees our potential, and gives us the courage and the gumption to get out of that tree so that we might receive the gift of new vision and the reordering of priorities. It's well worth the risk to accept Jesus' invitation to let him into our homes, our hearts, our minds, our souls. In the end, Jesus declares that salvation has come to the house of Zacchaeus. He was lost. He had gotten confused about why he was here and whom he was to serve. And he learned that his true home is, wherever Jesus leads him. And I think we're all a little bit like Zacchaeus. You and me, we are. So thank God that Jesus comes looking for us as well and invites us all to live a better life. Thanks be to God.
Our hymn of response to today's message, I saw the Rich Ones. I'll play through this one time because it's a fairly new hymn for us. And just keep your ears open because there's some kind of unexpected rhythmic stuff going on. Thank you.
When we gather as Christ's church, we celebrate the gifts of so many others, for so many centuries offered in Jesus' name. Now is our opportunity to join our gifts to theirs, so that God will be praised and Jesus' love will be spread in this generation and those to come. Financial gifts, of course, may be left in the offering plate to my right, or arrangements can be made with the church office to obtain envelopes or to arrange pre-authorized remittance. Receive all we offer today and every day. May each person who is touched by our offerings know your love for them. Amen. Share your good news. You shape our hearts with the tools of compassion so we will seek justice for all. We thank you, God of gifts. In the hospitality of Zacchaeus, we see your openness for all who are different. In the grumbling of his neighbors, we hear the echoes of our own prejudices and fears. In his transformation into a new person, we see your grace, which is prepared for us. We thank you, seeker of the lost. You cradle us in the peace of the resting night. You awaken us with the light of dawn and the warmth of your gentleness. You walk with us through each day, nudging us to be that blessing we are called to be to others. We thank you, surprising Spirit. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Righteous God, whose vision for the world we see in Jesus' ministry, we pray for your church. When injustice or complacency blurs, grant us clear eyes and voices that we may serve not the rulers of this age, but your reign. Grow our faith and increase our love for one another. We pray for this church, Central Saanich United Church, that barriers to its plans for the future be removed, so that the hopes and dreams for sharing the gospel in practical ways among us and through us to the wider community will be realized. We pray for strength and endurance and the ongoing commitment of our dedicated church leaders and for all who serve this community of faith with gifts of time, talent, and treasure. God of creation, of ants and elephants, of gardens and fields, of molehills and mountains, you treasure all sizes. Sustain every part of your creation and make us conscious of our interdependence. God of tadpoles and caterpillars, you treasure change and transformation. Teach us the beauty of new perspectives. God of the nations, each nation has its own brand of violence. Where war rages, may victims find shelter and refuge. Where oppression or injustice reigns, may those who protest and resist have courage. Use our laws to curb our shortcomings and to lift up the downtrodden. We are mindful of the violence around the globe, and even in our own country, our own local neighborhoods, the unprovoked attacks, the shootings, the wounding and killing of the innocent. Help us find a way to stop the madness. God of mercy, bring comfort, strength, and healing to the sick and suffering, the isolated and lonely, the grieving and troubled. Be present with us in every situation, filling us with your peace. When our ailments are invisible to others and even to ourselves, shake loose our understandings. Help us be part of healthy communities, weeping with those who weep, rejoicing with those who rejoice, loving our neighbors as ourselves. Compassionate God, as you've heard this prayer of one for many, please now hear our individual prayers of thanksgiving or concern offered silently from our hearts. O God, who sees us, open our eyes to see you. May we accept your invitation to be at home with us. We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to your care, trusting in Jesus Christ, the light and life of the world, who taught us to pray aloud and together, saying, Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And we have Goldie Oldie hymn to share next.